Brushing your hair?
Wow. Wow, you want to brush my hair? Okay, maybe in the video. All right, welcome back to the channel. My name is Zach, and this is Gloria, and today's Thursday, so we have a new theological term. Boom! All right. Today's word is exegesis. Can you say exegesis? Gloria, exegesis is when we draw the meaning out of a text of scripture. So it basically in Greek, exegesis means narration or explanation. And so when someone is preaching and they are doing expository preaching, they are drawing the meaning out of a particular text of scripture in order to demonstrate what that text actually means to the people that are listening to the sermon. So essentially, when it comes down to it, exegesis is a process, and it's an analytical process of looking at a text and properly exegeting it, bringing the meaning out from the text, the meaning that it meant for the original audience, as well as for us today, so that we can have a proper interpretation of that text and therefore apply that text to our lives. Whether that be a description of a text, you know, a narrative that's going on through the passage that we're reading, which is just meant to describe what is going on, versus a prescription of the text, which is meant to prescribe a truth of the gospel or a truth of God's word to us. And ideally, exegesis involves looking at the original languages of scripture and not just looking at the English text and trying to figure out what's going on. You look at the original languages, the Greek, the Hebrew, or the Aramaic, and then you draw out the meaning of what that particular verse or pericope or passage means in the original context as well as for us today. It's kind of like a little town. You have two different towns. One town is the town of the day of Scripture, where the events, the historical context, and everything going on, the culture, all of that is in this town. And in order to get to the next town, which is our day, and our understanding of how to apply a particular text, we must build a bridge between that town and our town so that we can properly understand what it means for us today. Now, interestingly, the noun exegesis is not found in the New Testament, but the verb form of exegesis, which is exogeomai, which means to lead out of, is found in a couple of places in the New Testament. It's found once in Luke, once in John, and four times in the book of Acts. We see in John 1:18 that it says, "No one has seen God at any time. The only begotten God who is in the bosom of the Father, he has explained him." So the verb form of exegesis is that part right there where it says that he has explained him. So essentially that verse is saying, "No one has seen God at any time. The only begotten God who is in the bosom of the Father, he has exegeted him," that is Christ. And so because we have an understanding of who God is, God himself is explaining Christ. And when we look at Christ, Christ himself explains who God is because he is God manifest in human flesh, the divine person, fully God and fully man, who took on human flesh. And the disciples who were on the road to Emmaus, who had encountered the risen Christ, exegeted or explained what happened to them, to the other disciples. And we see that in Luke 24:35, when it says, "They began to relate their experiences on the road and how he, Jesus, was recognized by them in the breaking of the bread." And we see in Acts 10, verse 8, that Cornelius exegeted his vision to his servants before he sent them to find Peter and bring him to him. And he says, "And after he had explained everything to them, he sent them to Joppa." And then we see in Acts 15:12 that Paul and Barnabas exegeted the importance of the miracles that had been done and the wonders that had taken place among the Gentiles to the Jerusalem Council. And we see that when it says, "All the people kept silent, and they were listening to Barnabas and Paul as they were relating what signs and wonders God had done through them among the Gentiles." And then we see two verses later in Acts 15:14 that Peter exegeted to the same Jerusalem Council God's first outreach in his ministry to the Gentiles. And it says, "Simeon has related how God first concerned himself about taking from among the Gentiles a people for his name." And then the last instance is in Acts 21:19, where it says that Paul exegeted to James and the Jerusalem elders in detail about what God had done through him among the Gentiles. And we see that when it says, after he had greeted them, that's Paul began to relate one by one the things which God had done among the Gentiles through his ministry. So based on what we've read, we can understand that ultimately exegesis in its basic meaning is an explanation. And so when we explain something to someone else, we give the context of it. And that's why I'm always saying that in order to properly understand a biblical verse or a passage of scripture, we have to know the context of it. And so to have proper biblical interpretation, there are three rules: context, context, and context. And on the flip side of exegesis, there's a word called eisegesis. An eisegesis is not drawing the meaning out of the text, but putting one's own meaning into the text that wasn't there in the first place. And so this kind of goes completely against the idea, and obviously the talking point and our battle cry for when we are interpreting scripture. We can't just put what we want into the text. We have to say, what saith the scripture? So we have to draw out the actual meaning of the text, what the Holy Spirit is actually saying with the plain words that are on the text of Scripture. It's essentially reading into the text what that particular reader wants it to say. And you probably won't be surprised by this, but this happens all the time in liberal circles of theology. They will speak of having the reader's response to a text as more significant and more important than the author's intent of that text. It's kind of like going to a Bible study and sitting around and we're looking at a passage of scripture. Let's say we're looking somewhere in, you know, Romans 8, and then all of a sudden, you know, we read the text and then we say, you know what, guys? You know what, Billy? What does this text mean to you? Johnny, what does this text mean to you? Gloria, what does this text mean to you? Zach, what does this text mean to you? And ultimately, this kind of interpretation of the text, by putting what we want to say in the text and by just seeing what it says to us specifically, is taking it out of context, and it has no respect for the grammatical context of what is being said in the scriptures or the intended significance of that particular text. It's basically saying what this text simply means to me rather than looking at the importance of what the text actually says, regardless of whether that understanding by that person has anything remotely to do with what the text says. We have to guard the role of exegesis against unwarranted spiritualizing of a particular text. Ultimately, any application of scripture that does not flow with the inspired writer's intent has no scriptural basis and provides no scriptural basis for belief or action. The method must be explanation that leads to meditation that ultimately leads to application. So we explain the text of scripture, and then the hearers of that scripture meditate on what it means based off of what has been explained, and then we are to go and apply what that text of scripture is. And when we do this, we demonstrate that we are obedient to scripture in belief and practice. So let me give you a brief example of eisegesis versus exegesis. And this is a classic verse that everyone loves, Philippians 4:13. I can do all things through him who strengthens me. So eisegesis would just be by looking at that text and saying, you know what? This says that I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. So if Christ is strengthening me, then I can do all things. It's kind of like Evander Holyfield wearing his boxing shorts and it said Philippians 4:13 on it, and then he gets knocked out. Or as a student saying, you know, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. So if I believe that Christ will strengthen me, then I can get a 100 on this exam without doing any studying or any preparation. It's like a husband saying, you know what, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Which means if I don't put any effort into parenting my kids or any effort into my marriage, then it's going to be successful because Christ strengthens me and I can do all things because of it. Now, obviously, those are not the proper biblical understanding of Philippians 4:13. We have to look at the historical context of that in order to understand what it actually means for us today in order to apply it to our own understanding. And so we look at what I mentioned before. We have this town, which is the town of, you know, the original writing of this verse and this passage and this letter to the church in Philippi. And then we have our town today, and we have to make a bridge across it from their town to our town to have a proper understanding of what this verse means. So if we look at the context of this passage, there are three things that we can take away. Firstly, Paul is a Christian. The second thing is that Paul is being persecuted and he is in prison for faithfully serving Christ and for preaching the gospel and doing whatever it takes to follow the Lord's call to deny himself and to go forth and proclaim the gospel among the nations. And so Paul is experiencing trying circumstances as a result of his faithful service to the gospel and to Jesus Christ. So the third thing is that Christ will give strength to Christians so that they can endure any circumstance in this life. So let's go back to our example of Evander Holyfield, who's in our particular context, and compare it to the particular context that Paul is in. So they both fulfill the first item, that they're Christians, and they both fulfill the third item, that they believe that they can do all things through Christ who strengthens them, and are missing one key aspect that links and intersects these two other elements that we've talked about, which is the original situation that Paul was writing this, which is ultimately his persecution for being a Christian and his faithful service to Christ. So Paul and Evander Holyfield have completely different understandings of the phrase, I can do all things. So when we look at the historical context of Philippians 4:13, all things is referring to the variety of trying circumstances that the believer will experience. So during this specific context, Paul is experiencing a trial of need instead of a trial of plenty. So when Paul says that he can do all things, he is referring to being content or enduring rather than conquering. So there is a major difference between the trials of an athletic competition and the trials of being imprisoned for your faith in Christ. So that's just one example of exegesis, drawing the actual meaning out of the text so that one can meditate on that and then apply it specifically to their lives as a result of a proper understanding of what the text says. All right, Gloria, that is exegesis. Can I get a high five? All right, can I get a fist bump? Boom. If you like this video, be sure to hit the thumbs up button. But if you love the video, please consider subscribing to the channel. If you haven't already gotten your SDG merch, you can get this t-shirt today, which is all of our theological terms from March 2019 to March 2020. Get yours today. It's got words like aseity, angel of the Lord, sola fide, spiritual disciplines, faith, sola scriptura, a bunch of these different terms that we've gone over. So get yours today at the link in the description as well as the merchandise shelf. And if you'd like to follow me on Instagram or Twitter, my handles are right here. And you can also go on Facebook and type in the SDG by ZAC and like our Facebook page. This is the SDG by ZAC. Soli Deo Gloria. To God alone be the glory. With Theological Terms Thursday with Gloria. We wish you providential blessings. Take care. We'll catch you next time. Hey, Gloria. Thumbs up. Good job. Are we supposed to be climbing on the trampoline right now? Wow. Okay. You just want to jump? Just want to jump? Okay. Come here. Come here. Come here.
Toto.
Gloria. Mo grandma.
Okay.
Are you pooping? Are you pooping? You're doing weird noises. You're not pooping? Okay, if I start smelling something and you didn't, I'm gonna say you lied. You pooped?